I'm Shelley Duvall.
And you're listening to WOOPLP, Cleveland, Tennessee. WOOP FM is a broadcasting service of the Traditional Music Resource Center, and we play America's original music.
Is it time for a new ride? At Buy Here, Pay Here USA, for just $500 today, you can drive it away. Come by any of our four locations in Chattanooga, Cleveland, Dayton, and Dalton, Georgia, and find your new ride. For just $500 down, you can drive it away today. Remember, all our vehicles have passed a 200-point inspection and come with a 6-month, 6,000-mile warranty. And you get a free Carfax report and appraisal on your vehicle. Visit us at buyherepayhereusa.com. Offer subject to credit approval. See store for details. We are Buy Here, Pay Here USA.
Did you know that U.S. Money Shops cashes all checks, even the ones most check cashers reject? Tax refund checks, government checks, payroll checks, and many more. And when you cash a check with U.S. Money Shops, we'll give you 10% off your next purchase. At U.S. Money Shops, we have everything you need at a fraction of regular retail. So stop by one of our 11 locations or visit us online at usmoneyshops.com.
Buy yourself a pie today. The better way at U.S. Money Shops.
Some restrictions may apply. See store for details.
Good morning, Cleveland, Bradley County. Coach Shriver here on the morning show, Pop-Up Radio, 614-5553. Welcome to WHOOP FM 99.9. Hope everyone is doing well. You want to tune in 99.9? You want to check us out on the internet? You just go to whoopfm.com and hit live, and you'll be able to actually see us on the radio. And we appreciate it when you do that. Very balmy out there this morning. It's kind of weird, folks. Here it is. We're, what, 4 days, 5 days from Christmas, and here we're talking about 51 degrees this morning, going to push up to 60. Tomorrow's going to be 60, 63. I mean, it's just, it's kind of weird, kind of weird. Then they are kind of calling for a little bit of cold weather, maybe on Christmas Day. Sure would be nice if we could have a little covering of snow for Christmas. I love snow on Christmas. I remember growing up in the Northwood, and we always could have, we always expected and always had snow on Christmas. That was a fun thing. So anyway, let's hope that we get a little touch of it anyway. Just balmy is not good for me for Christmas. I'll never forget as a kid, I spent a Christmas in Florida once. And I tell you, that was shocking to a young kid. I was probably about 12 at the time. And my parents and I went down to visit my sister who had just got married and moved down there. And I'll never forget, the weirdest thing about it was the Christmas parade, and Santa rolled by on wheels. And I thought, hold it now. This is just not right. What is this? On wheels? Are you kidding me? I said, you know, at home we had the horse and sleigh, man, and we used to take those rides and hear the bells and everything. And I'm serious now. That's the way it was. It was a good time, good stuff. All right, 614-5553. Give us a call on WHOOP. We got a guest coming in this morning, beautiful young lady who's connected with the Bradley Cleveland Public Education Foundation, Shari Buckner, and she's going to give us some info on what's going on with that right now. Within the last week or two, they've handed out a lot of grants and all that kind of stuff. Also have with me my sidekick, who's been with me all month. I'll tell you what, I appreciate him. Tom Casta in here again this morning. And Tom, how you doing, big guy?
I'm doing great. How's those WHOOP listeners doing out there this morning?
Hey, man.
Give us a call.
We got some things about Santa and all that kind of stuff, and packages and everything going on there. So we may have a chance today to get in on that as soon as our guest is just coming in here. She looks so bright-eyed and bushy-tailed this morning and we sure appreciate her getting up this early. Now I know that she probably had to sacrifice in order to, you know how women are. They like to make sure everything's cool. So she probably was up at 5 this morning.
Yeah.
Shari, what do you say about that?
Not really. I rolled out of bed a little after 6. My dog looked at me like, what are we doing up this early?
I was telling
you. You got up before the dog did?
I did. Yeah, she likes to sleep late. So.
Yeah. The kids are like that, aren't they?
Yeah.
Babies. Well, when you get to the empty nest syndrome and you're kind of pushing that right now.
I'm kind of there. They're all home right now.
So, are they? Well, that's great. That's great. Yeah, I was telling Tom, my dog got me up at 5 this morning, which was wonderful because he and I went to bed at 9:30, and that's 7.5 hours. Anytime you can get 7.5 hours out of a 10-week-old pup,
that
bladder's working pretty good. And boy, he was definitely ready to release. But it was good. He's doing much better, thank goodness. This old man can't take much of those middle of the night things. Not like I used to. Anyway, folks, we got, again, this is Whoop FM, Coach Shriver in the morning. Good to have you with us today. Be careful out there. Now, I can truthfully say now, no fake news today. There is no school today. My sidekick here led me to believe that school was all out this week. And of course, now he's misled
me.
We
have two counties. We have a county and a city, okay? The county let out early. So
all right, so evidently you were more connected with the county last week than you were the city, because he forgot the city was still in until yesterday. But anyway, yes, schools. I started to tell you that Tom has misled me a couple times this week. You know, I've always told you and I've always preached that there'll be no fake news on this show. Well, he led me to believe last week that Ohio State had – UTC had beaten Ohio State in wrestling, and so we announced it. Then I get over to my Liars Table buddies, and next thing I walk in, and they just cackling and carrying on, and says, "What are you wrong with you? That was Ohio. That wasn't Ohio State." And I said, "Well," I said, "no wonder Heath acted so shocked when I called him this morning, and he was so nice as he is. He just went right along with it." But anyway, they had a great win over Ohio, and I think they wrestled Ohio State very well, too. But again, it's, you know, we do have occasionally we have to cover up and apologize for fake news, and I promised you that. And again, as I've said in the past, we're trying to really push our community organizations and community service organizations. I've already talked to our fire chief, and several other people are going to come on after Christmas and talk with us and give everybody an opportunity. But this month, we've dedicated ourselves to public education, and we've had someone on every day except for, Tuesday?
Tuesday
was the only day we had catch-up, and that was fun. We had a good time here going over some things. And but again, maybe later on, we'll talk a little bit about Whoop and its impact on the kids for Christmas and stuff like that. My sidekick brought in a few questions about that. And also, while I'm right here, I don't want to forget this. Emphasize again, we lost Ron Moore a while back, and we're very, very sad about that. I want to remind you, remember tonight from 6 to 8 on the Good Sports program, they're going to be doing stories about Ron. You want to call in, you got a story about him, Arnold's going to take care of that. 614-5553. That'll be a good opportunity to, you know, share something or a reason why Ron has been so important to you. And again, remember that the service is going to be after Christmas, December 29th, and visitation will be 3 to 7 at First Baptist Church, followed by the service. So keep keeping their family in your prayers and all that. But again, tonight will be a good opportunity for you to call in here on Whoop, and again, 614-5553, and tell a story about Ron. I'm sure everyone will enjoy it, appreciate it. And I've been in contact with Debbie, and she's hanging in there. Family's doing good. And again, loss of anyone is especially at Christmas time. I know it's never good any time, but Christmas just seems to be. And later on, we're going to talk a little bit about yesterday was signing day for the colleges, and Tennessee did good. I'll put a plug out for them. They signed 7 people from Tennessee.
Yay.
So I was very impressed with Pruitt on that part of it, and I hope I'm obvious that they're probably good candidates. But again, we'll talk about that later. Right now, we got to get back with our girl, Shari Buckner. And Shari, welcome to Whoop FM.
Well, thank you. Thank you. I had the pleasure of being here a few times with Mark in the morning.
Yeah.
So,
well, I'm not Mark, and we miss Mark for sure. And you know, he was just a different character, a different person.
That's an understatement. But so are you.
You're
a character too. So.
Yeah, right. Oh yeah. Well, I don't know. Some people might. I don't know. Anyway, well, Shari, give us a little insight. And all right, just exactly what is your part in the public education? I remember when I started it back in 2003. we got you in there and got you involved and all that kind of stuff. What are you doing now?
Okay, so I'm still on the executive committee of the Public Education Foundation, which I guess you were a part of it getting started. And I was thinking about that this morning on coming in, how I got involved. And, you know, Ralph and I had always been contributors to the Public Education Foundation. And they had a luncheon one day up at the Holiday Inn in up on the hill. And I was talking to Nancy Kaysen, who is the current board member of the Bradley school system. And I told her, I said, this is an organization I'd like to be involved with. I worked at TVA at the time, and my kids were at E.L. Ross Elementary School. And my daughter was in second grade, and I was volunteering as much as I could. Working full-time, I would try to volunteer in the classrooms. And they had this math game that was really for second graders, and it was, you know, understanding math concepts and repetition. And so some of the volunteers would play this game with the kids. So I talked to Mrs. Sharp. Naomi Sharp was her teacher. And I said, where did you get this? This is really great. And she said, well, I wrote a grant for it and got it through the Public Education Foundation. And I was like, oh, that's the thing that Nancy and I had talked about. So that's really what spurred me to get involved, is to actually see an organization who, you know, you contribute to or support, and they actually make a difference in the classroom. The money, you were involved, you know, in the mini grants. It's expanded to a lot of other things, but it was announced in the paper, I think, last week, that $55,000 this year.
How many grants was that? Do you remember?
I believe it was 13 grants. And some of the, and I can't remember the distribution between city and county, but usually it's about two-thirds to the county and one-third to the city based on the
enrollment.
Based on the enrollment, but it's also the applications. So sometimes we get more from the city and sometimes less. Generally, we get more from the county, though. And the grants are judged blindly. So the people judging the grants, they don't know if it's city or county or who it is. They judge it based on its merit. Yeah. So that's the other thing I like about it, is you don't just give money just because it's a county school.
That was one of the things that we wanted in the beginning, was we wanted it to be neutral. Mm-hmm. And so when they came in, we always removed the cover sheets and checked to make sure there wasn't any kind of a way of connecting it with city or county.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And then the readers, we used to have the readers come in, and I think you did that a couple times.
I did.
And I'm sure that's probably the same way they're doing it now, but they would read through them, and then they'd have, you know, votes and whatever. But anyway,
one thing I wanted to point out, this year, I believe, is the first year we've had a grant for both, the one grant written for two different schools in two different systems. So what we're seeing is a lot of collaboration between teachers for school-wide grants. So you may have a team of seventh grade teachers at Cleveland Middle School come together, write a grant that would benefit all the disciplines of education in that.
Can you talk a little bit about that grant? Do you know anything about that grant?
I believe it was Michigan Avenue and Arnold
with the
schools.
Grant.
I brought my laptop.
Okay,
I can look
we'll
it
get
up
back
here
to that
in
later.
Just a minute.
Then.
Yeah.
He's always got to be put you on the spot.
No, I didn't mean put her on the spot on that part.
You can't. So. You know these politicians. You can't.
No, I didn't mean that.
He's got his hand in your pocket already.
The tax bill passed. I watched that interview the other day with Bob Corker and Wolf Blitzer. Is that his name?
Mm-hmm.
I was like, whoa, it got a little heated there.
Don't get me on Corker.
Okay.
Enough said.
But anyway, it's been a real joy. You know, Dwayne was one of the founders of this Education Foundation, and it's just really blossomed from there.
Lynn's doing a great job.
Lynn Bowles is the executive director, and I mean, talk about a workhorse. If you don't just sit on the board with her, you work, and that's a good thing. It's great for the city of Cleveland and the county schools and everyone involved.
Some of the things I've been looking and observing through the foundation now is like. Explain. Now, we know we got Lynn who directs it and that kind of thing. I know she has some assistants helping her, too. And I like your, is it a board of directors, trustees? How you doing that?
Executive committee.
Executive committee. It's like called, how many are on that?
There, I think we have 15 on there now. I think the maximum we can have is 19. Both directors of schools are automatically on it. That position is always there. And we have some of us who've been around a long time. Me, Rebecca McIntyre, of course my mind's going blank. Ron Braum. We have some new people on the executive committee. Nancy Blank, we all know her. She's eye doctor here in town. Cheryl Jaggers. Matt Bentley has been instrumental in really pushing the Education Foundation forward. Vanessa Kahn, you know, she's very involved at Lee, and she's been very instrumental in moving the Education Foundation forward. She's the current president right now. Kathy Botner, Keith Barrett, Jimmy Williams, Sherry Brown. We have some really good executives. Yes, good
really
people
good
that care, that care yeah. about it. And it's one of those things that you go to the meeting, and let me mention Brenda Lawson. She has been on it since probably day one.
Brenda supports anything that's going on out there.
Yeah,
she's
very good and very has been there since day one and really supports education in our community.
Yeah, she just had her little Christmas thing here recently, and she does that every year and supports that every year, and it's just so, you know, it's so good to see all you people and all the individuals. You know, number one bottom line is kids, and that's what we need to be about. And folks, as I here we are again on the morning show with Coach Shriver here, 99.9 Whoop FM, 614-5553. Don't be afraid to give us a call and ask a question. But again, it's something that we keep promoting is the services to our community, to our kids. Now, we're not just talking about kids, but we're talking about the entire community. But the important thing is the fact that we're working together and we're wanting to help everybody in the community. That's what makes us strong and makes us family, and that's so key. So, Shari, as far as some of the, can you give us some kind of an idea of maybe some of the type of grants that they had this year? Or
I haven't seen the list. I mean, normally, it's providing. You know, it's not like capital money. It doesn't do anything for the schools. It's not money. It's money that goes
teaching incentives
and teaching tools, teaching software, teaching. You know, we've done musical programs where they buy drums. I think Arnold had a trash can band there where you buy instruments or you buy things that go in the classroom. Things that are used multiple years are very, very looked highly upon in the
keep recycling and using
right materials, learning materials.
Long-term.
Yes, some we put iPads in different schools with, you know, learn. I know, I guess the third grade in, I think it was Michigan Avenue. This has been 5 or 6 years ago when iPads first came out, put them in there. We went in the classroom and the teacher would pull out their iPads. They would check the weather. They would check the time, different things going on. So they're familiar with what's going on in the world around them.
Mm-hmm.
Music, we've had, a lot of math, you know, what's the math competition to help kids prepare
well,
for that.
Well, math and science was always big. I remember when we first started it. Seems like we really emphasized at that time math and science things, and then they kind of stretched out to other things. We got into, I know we had one that did a history of the Nazi stuff in Germany back in the day, and that was very, very, very interesting. And
we've had history on Tennessee for elementary schools and middle schools. We've also, I don't know if you're familiar with the STEAM lab, science, technology, engineering, and arts and math that they've just put up at Charleston. And that wasn't part of the mini-grant program, But that was led by kind of Cleveland Associated Industry, and Ron Braun put together a team of industries that funded the lab up at Charleston Elementary, and I believe it opened this fall.
Well, I think if I'm not mistaken, all three of the high schools have a mm-hmm. STEM thing program, and then the I'm even thinking maybe the middle schools do too. But
yes.
We were fortunate enough back the last 2 weeks having the city school principals we had elementary. We had middle school, and we had high school in the city, and then last weekend we had the high school, all three of the high school principals, and of course, Dr. Dyer and Dr. Cash.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, they were talking about the STEM program, and it really is, it's great to see how they've developed all these things. And
well,
it's so
one
important.
Example, the schools have really done a great job in ramping up the science and technology. What the foundation does is we may give that little bit of extra that would be needed, like in the Cleveland High School New Science Wing. I remember one of the grants from a couple of years ago were the little clickers that the kids can have the clickers, the teacher can ask a question, the kids can mm-hmm. can use the clickers, and it's all automated up on the board. They can answer questions, they can make choices, and that just enhanced the teacher's ability to be a little more effective, a little more efficient, and it wasn't that big of a grant, but it made a huge difference in the classroom.
Yeah. And kids respond to that kind of thing.
Kids respond to technology.
They love anything they can put in their hands, and this here, the technology thing.
I just got to say that I'm impressed with the teachers.
Oh,
I mean,
my gosh.
The teachers are so... you know, we don't give them enough credit on that part. They are the ones out there writing the grants.
Right, absolutely.
Not only they just don't apply, they have to write a grant and what it's going to be used for. I mean, so they're taking the extra time to do that because they love their kids so much.
And actually,
and
we
want to make a difference in their lives.
The foundation provides workshops for the teachers to help them write grants. And they come in on Saturdays. They come in on their off day to learn how to write a better grant, which helps them with our grants. But they also use these skills to write grants to other organizations.
I challenge people in public, when you see a teacher next time, tell them thank you for what they do for the community. I really
absolutely.
Do. Just like you do an officer. Teachers are so important to our community.
Well, I think that, you know, we've got a situation where in this kind of a situation with the grants, too, basically what it comes down to is the individuals have the desire and willingness to go ahead and do that because it takes, you know, they're busy enough as it is.
Exactly.
So some will say, I just don't have time for it. But those who will go above and beyond, take on that grant writing thing, go for the training, do all that kind of stuff, it's just key because it's definitely above and beyond. But the reward in the end is you getting that service, that help, those innovative techniques in your classroom. And I think that, you know, yes, it takes a little extra gumption to get those things. So
absolutely.
And it's
we're like you said, we're blessed in Cleveland to have those. Cleveland and Bradley County, both systems, to have those teachers that go the extra mile. I mean, we've just got phenomenal teachers here.
Definitely. And as you're looking towards the future, I remember back in the early, when we first got this going, back in the 03, 4, 5, 6, and there, we seemed like we handed out maybe a little more money, and we also handed out a lot more grants. I guess maybe they were maybe smaller or whatever it was. They weren't as large. I don't know how
right. I think when you guys started out, most of the grants were around $500. Mm-hmm. And now they're, like I said, a lot of them are collaborative, and they're getting up to, I think the maximum is $5,000 we do for mm-hmm. a team grant. So a lot of them are $2,000, $3,000, $4,000. But usually there's three or four teachers involved and multiple disciplines, like you have math, science, and English working together to provide a grant, and those seem to have more legwork too. I mean, you know, longevity that lasts multiple years. Mm-hmm. They're looking forward thinking and looking at things they can use 3 to 5 years down the road.
Well, I think one thing too is we develop any kind of a program, you get into something, you know, you kind of experiment in the early stages and stuff, and then you start to train and learn more about what's out there and what you can do and what you can be accepted. And again, that's all taken on by the teacher's willingness to get out there and research and find things that they can put in their classroom to help their classroom or their school, you know, just a total school project or something like that. Mm-hmm. And so that's very key.
It is. And one of the things that was in the early days, it was kind of unheard of. I believe it started out as the Cleveland City Schools Foundation, and then they added the mm-hmm. Bradley schools to it. So it, in the, you know, the city where with two
yeah,
governments.
Margo mm-hmm. and Rodney mm-hmm. kind of started off on this in the city end of it.
Right.
I'm not sure. I can't remember exactly. I think Bradley had kind of a small one, had just gotten started. So when we decided to go to the Bradley-Cleveland Public Education and bring everything together, then it just started to kind of get a better grip, and then actually having someone to organize it, and so it wasn't all responsibility of someone in the central office or
right, and there was the perception that one school system might get more or the other, so that kind of took that away. And another thing that has well, I just lost my train of thought. We were talking
Welcome.
About the early.
All right. Thank you, Laura.
Must be something in the air.
When you walk in this room, it happens. The other day, I couldn't remember his name. I haven't known him more than 40 years. And so that's okay.
Okay. Right. It's okay. Well, I've got several things racing through my brain, but what was I going to talk about? I was going to mention that the both school systems participate in the funding of the Public Education Foundation.
Yes. They each put a little bit in for salary.
They each put a little bit in for salary and administrative costs. The Cleveland City Schools had offered office space for the past probably 8 or 9 years at the Star Center. Just recently, the Public Education Foundation has moved to the old library. I don't know if you knew that. Mm-hmm. They have the upstairs. It's beautiful. If you're ever in the old library, just go upstairs and see if they've renovated the upstairs. And this was with the help of the library board and the Tucker Foundation. They helped renovate the old building, and it's just beautiful upstairs. We have office space, we have conference rooms, and that way donors can come in and other people, you know, involved in the education, you know, the school systems can come in.
That's
and
great.
Yeah, it's more centrally located than the Star Center. And so that's what the foundation is very thankful to have the support of both school systems, the city and the county, that support it financially every year also.
Like how many people does Lynn have helping her?
She has a grant writer and I believe another part-time person.
Okay. Yeah.
Yes.
All right. Yeah.
So it's a slim, for what they do, it's a very slim organization, and but they get a lot done.
Good. Well, that's great to know about the library. I didn't know that. You're right.
Yeah,
I have to check that out.
But it's beautiful what they've done upstairs. Yeah. I'd good. Like to live up there.
All right. Well, good. Do you hear anything more about any of the situations that maybe they're going to try to broaden the foundation in any particular ways or do anything different?
With more money, we'll do whatever.
We will continue to
broaden as the money comes in. That's one thing. We're not hiring, you know, we're not building a big staff. If you compare our foundation, like even with Chattanooga's, they're...
I remember when we started ours. I went down there.
Their salaries are crazy.
I can't remember how many mm-hmm. At that time, how
really?
Many employees they had.
Mm-hmm.
They had that whole floor there in the Times Building,
mm-hmm.
and it was phenomenal. And of course, they had umpteen. I met with their board of trustees one day. They're coming here. They're coming in here, and I'm seeing these people who are, you know, big bucks and all that kind of stuff. They're supporting them. And that's really good, really, really good.
Yeah. So, you know, we're small, we're lean, but we, you know, and it's a good, one thing I haven't really talked about, it's a good avenue for like telemedicine. The grants, I believe it comes from United Way, to through the Public Education Foundation to fund telemedicine in the schools. That's where you have the I guess it's like a little van that goes around to different schools that helps.
That's great.
Yeah. Oh, gosh. It helps so many kids that don't have health care or don't have the ability to find it. So we do also things like that. If a school has a grant that they've written and they need a 501c3 organization to run it through, that's the Public Education Foundation. That's the 501c3 arm of our schools. And it's, you know, it does a good job in getting grants to the right places also. And but I believe all the high schools are now have alumni associations that...
Those things are growing and getting a whole lot
better. Those
things
are growing where you have alumni.
And we're getting a lot more alumni behind it that are helping push it. And I think that's you got to have that. You got to have your parents involved. You got to have your alumni involved.
Exactly.
And this is some of the things that yes, that's key.
Yeah, the alumni are very strong. I didn't grow up here in Cleveland. I'm a Purple Pounder, a Chattanooga Central.
We won't hold that against you. You're like me, all right?
Yeah.
I'm a Yankee.
Yeah, but I'm not a Yankee. You can't call Hamilton County a Yankee.
But I got here as soon as I could, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and so,
yeah.
Anyway.
Actually, I live 3 miles from Bradley County, but we lived in Hamilton County, so everything I did was in Hamilton County. Except my mom liked to go to, there was a shoe store here. Was it? No, in the other Cleveland mall she liked to go to. I don't even remember the name of it.
I know which one you mean.
Okay, yeah.
I better not say
the
words because I'd be wrong. So.
Yeah, and then we would come up here to the movies, to this little movie theater here. So that's about all I would do in Cleveland. But it was
cool. And look where you end up.
And look at me now.
Oh, golly. Get connected to one of them Cleveland High alums.
Alum, yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, Tom, you got any other questions you'd like to ask this young lady?
I don't have anything. I do have a check for her, though.
Oh.
Donation, because I did get a letter. I missed your function, so I did want to pass that on for me and my wife.
Thank you.
Foundation to help out with that. So
we are very appreciative.
Well, I'll tell you what, this guy's something else.
I know.
You wouldn't believe what he's brought me this week. And I apologize. He brought me the cutest little hat. Last week, and then he brought me Bruce Spruce over here.
Yeah.
You know, okay. That's
and
cute.
And then he brought me a chocolate pie the other day.
How was that chocolate pie? Huh? How was that chocolate pie?
I haven't touched it. I'm saving it for my family.
Okay.
Out, so,
right.
And I'm sure it's good.
Okay. Yeah. I wouldn't share it with the family. I'd eat every bit of it.
That chocolate pie wouldn't last very long in my house.
Fudge chocolate pie.
Oh, yeah, that would be great.
When I got home and showed it to my wife, the first thing she said to me, put it in the freezer. She wouldn't even let me open the box.
Yeah.
Put it in the freezer.
Yeah.
Okay. So, anyway.
You got.
She knew me.
Big crowd coming.
Oh, yeah. We're getting all the family in. This is good. Every other year we get them all.
That's one
of those things, those families, you know, every other year, they go,
yeah.
they go to Thanksgiving
they go to the
one year,
and
Christmas
year,
the
yeah.
next.
Now, how many total is it, roughly? How many people?
Oh, it's not big. It's just our family.
Okay.
And,
I just wondered.
About 9 people. Right. 3 grandkids. And
so I just wanted to know if I had to send a fire marshal if you had too many people in your house, you know, as far as occupancy on that part.
We're a very small, unique group. You know, a very small and unique group. Okay, well, listen, folks, this is Coach Shriver here on the morning show, Pop-Up Radio, 614-5553. Hope you all are doing well. Be out there. Be safe. Now, you don't have to look for the school buses this morning, but be safe anyway. Leave early. It is balmy out there. The streets are wet. Going to be about, it's 51 when I got up, so it's probably warmer now. Going to hit close to 60 today. And then I think tomorrow it's even going to be warmer. Now, remember now, on our show, we're not having a show tomorrow. We're taking off for Christmas. We'll be off tomorrow, Monday and Tuesday. Hope everyone enjoys your Christmas holidays. And we'll be back a week from today to pick up before the new year. And then, again, we'll be off the following Monday and Tuesday for New Year's, too. But we want you to have a very, very safe and nice Christmas. So we're going to break here just for a second to give Shari a chance to catch her breath, and we're gonna play a little Christmas music. And, of course, I apologize. You know how when you control the controls, you like to do what you want to do. And so my favorite song is, I'm going to play it. I played that, I think it's the third time this week, and that's okay. But I hope you like Bing Crosby because, you know, I just like that White Christmas thing and always have ever since I was a kid. So we're going to play White Christmas, and I hope you enjoy it. And hang on, please.
All of the races are different.
Our nation's first Orcish police officer.
Hey. Enjoy! Welcome back to Whoop FM. I can't believe that was a quick one there. I must have had a quick version or something there. But again, we'll do some others here in a minute. And hope everyone is doing well out there again. Coach Shriver on the morning show. Whoop FM 99.9 614-5553. Give us a call if you got a question for Shari here about the Bradley County Public Education. Got a question for Tom. We'd just love to listen to you and have a hopefully there's a few out there. We see a few maybe be even watching. And we always like to have people who watch us. So hello out there, all two or three of you or whoever it is. And you five listeners, we're glad to have you too. So
I almost have a dozen, don't we?
Hey, I was really impacted and pleased the other day on Tuesday when I had individuals calling from Polk County and I've had people calling from Etowah. I had no idea that we reached that far. So, you know, everything's a surprise to you, and that's how you find out. When people call in, let us know. That's what it's supposed to be, a call-in show. It's supposed to be your show. So we'll make it what you want it to be. So give us a call and let us know what's going on there. And Well, Shari, can you think of anything else you'd like to say about the Public Education Foundation at this point in time? And I know it's hard sometimes to know exactly what's going on and where you're headed,
Well, our vision is to continue to provide for the kids of Bradley County. We continue to have kids coming in. We have different needs. We have, you know, English as a second language is a big part of what the schools have to deal with. So we try to enhance that. And if you weren't here earlier, I've been talking about the Bradley Cleveland Public Education Foundation and the work we do in the schools. And basically, we try to enhance education for the teachers. The money that is given by donors is put back into the classroom, and that's, you know, it's not spent on salaries and infrastructure, and, you know, the school systems, they have to deal with a lot of the infrastructure and the salary, those type issues in the schools. The public education, I kind of think of it as icing on the cake. It's the icing that helps the teachers teach. So through our mini grant program, we provide enhancements for the classroom teacher to make the classroom a more inviting and interesting and learning opportunity place for the kids.
Anything else from you, Mr. Castro?
Oh, I'm fine. I appreciate you. All of what y'all do and the time you spend in the foundation and helping out the teachers.
I mean,
it's just about
all volunteers that help with it, and you know, Cleveland is such a great community. There's so many great organizations to be involved with. This is one I've chosen. I'm you know, through our foundation we give to a lot of organizations, but my time and energy is spent with this organization.
Yes. I think, folks, one of the things you need to understand that this young lady here, I'm talking about Shari Buckner. The Public Education Foundation is not just all she does. She is involved in so many civic programs in the community and volunteers and gives her time and money and everything else to so many different things in our community. And we are so appreciative of having individuals like her. And of course, a list that goes on that if we started to name it, we'd forget several. Anyway, right now we'll talk about her and what she's done, and we're just so proud of everything that she's got. Such a sweet attitude, and she's just someone that you like to be around, and she's a good workout partner too. We kind of work out at the same place. So anyway, of course she puts me to shame. She embarrasses me every time I go in there, and she.
Well,
tells,
and I complain a lot if I have to do. What are those chin-ups, pull-ups? Those are my least favorite.
She can lift more than I can. So anyway, but Shari, thanks again for coming in. We appreciate
you're so
welcome. Love you.
Thank you for having me.
The community appreciates you and Junior and everything that your foundation, your own foundation does. And I know that with all the people involved with the Bradley Cleveland Public Education Foundation, all the good individuals who are volunteering, serving, and your executive committees, all those people out there, Lynn and the whole process, we're very appreciative of everything that they're doing for our kids. And I always like to emphasize the fact, folks, that kids are the most important thing. So we will get back with you again next week. We're not through today yet, but we're going to let Shari go because I know she's got a lot on her plate. She's got her family in and everything. And she's got her dogs to take care of, and one big
Christmas
dog.
Shopping.
Christmas shopping. Okay. Well,
I'm just kidding.
All right,
I've got a little of it done. I've got.
We're going to break off again here for another Christmas, another Dolly Parton one, Hard Candy Christmas. Love that one. So we're going to break off on that, and we'll be right back. Okay. Hang on there, folks. My technical skills are not very fast.
Holiday together, great things come in twos. Right now, when you buy any of this season's hot new Samsung Galaxy...
All right, here we go. Enjoy.
Hey, maybe... Maybe I'll dye my hair. Maybe I'll move somewhere. Maybe I'll get a car. Maybe I'll drive so far that I lose track. Me, I'll bounce right back. Maybe I'll sleep real late. Maybe I'll lose some weight. Maybe I'll clear my junk. Maybe I'll just get drunk on apple wine. Me, I'll be just fine, dandy. Lord, it's like a hard candy Christmas. I'm barely getting through tomorrow, but still I won't let sorrow bring the way down. I'll be fine and dandy. Lord, it's like a hard candy Christmas. I'm barely getting through tomorrow, but still I won't let sorrow bring me way down. Hey, maybe I'll learn to sew. Maybe I'll just lie low. Maybe I'll hit the bars. Maybe I'll count the stars until dawn. Me, I will go on. Maybe I'll settle down. Maybe I'll just leave town. Maybe I'll have some fun. Maybe I'll meet someone. Just fine and dandy. Lord, it's like a hard candy Christmas. I'm barely getting through tomorrow, but still I won't let sorrow bring me way down. I'll be fine and dandy. Lord, it's like a hard candy Christmas.
Hey, folks, welcome back. Whoop FM 99.9. Coach Shriver in the morning show. 614-5553. And I hope everyone is doing well out there this morning. Again, it's about 51, probably up a little bit now. And good to have you with us. We just had Shari Buckner talk to us today on the Bradley County Public Education, Bradley Cleveland Public Education Foundation. We appreciate her taking the time to come in and talk to us. She's a sweetheart. She really, really does a lot for our community, and we just appreciate her so much for everything she does. Like many, many others out there that are so involved with our community and giving to our community and being part of that, it's so important. And so we do appreciate all those people. Okay, folks, we're going to talk about some other things here today. I told you I wanted to talk a little bit about the signing day. You probably saw yesterday that on the signing day that I noticed the front page of the sports section today said that Georgia had early success landing nation's top class and new signing period. Of course, we all know how that goes. You know, that's that because they're listed that way. You know, you never know until down the road and see how they produce. Alabama signed 15, still has needs to address. You know, their depth is amazing, so you have to be careful there. And then, of course, Tennessee, managed to have sorry about that. I just got noticed that I was a little far away from my... Isn't it nice to have friends out there that you know that are listening and telling you you're not quite up to the mic? So thank you so much out there, Mark. And so listen, let's talk a little about Tennessee. Now, Tennessee signed 12, and the thing that impressed me most about that is I think when you got people that come in and are out from outside like Pruitt, and he managed to sign 7 Tennessee people, prospects, out of the 12. Now, I know they're not done. There's more coming there. But that is such an important thing, and we appreciate that so much that they're able to do that. And I think it's important if you can sign people in your state and show your loyalty to the state, that's key too. So we want to thank them for having that to happen. And anyway, we'll be keeping up with all this as it goes along because there's going to be more. Georgia signed, I can't remember how many, but, boy, they evidently got a good list.
18, it said.
18. Yeah, I'll tell 18. You what. So, and I'm not sure how many they're allowed, 25, 30. Yeah. It seems like it's 30. They're allowed to sign 30, I think, each year, unless they're on probation or on some kind of a penalty out there, which seems to be coming a lot. I'll tell you one thing I did notice today in the paper, and I don't know if you all saw this. Our Southern Conference showed up good. Did you see they defeated Wofford, defeated North Carolina, 75, 77 to 74. And you know how good Tennessee did against them last Sunday. They nearly pulled it off there, too. But Wofford beats North Carolina. Now, tell me that's not a big feather in their cap. Great. Hope I don't have that. I hope that wasn't North Carolina State. I hope I didn't give more fake news, but I think it was correct. It was North Carolina. So, but again, you never know what's going to happen out there. And so we'll be working on some of that stuff and keeping up with you and keeping you. My man Tom Casta came in here this morning. He brought me in a bunch of old 60s music to play, and we'll get started on that after the new year since we're working on Christmas stuff here. But it's really neat how he's been helpful and supportive of me, and I do appreciate it.
Coach, you got any history for today? We talked about basketball a little bit. Is there anything about the history today that, refers back to basketball?
We got a few things. You didn't know that. If you didn't know this, now, I remember this because it seems like we learned this as young kids. Being brought up in the North and New York, and, of course, Connecticut was right there close, Massachusetts. But you know in 1891, there were 18 students that played the first basketball game in Springfield College, located in Springfield, Mass. James Naismith, a 31-year-old graduate student who invited the game to he invented it, actually, the game of basketball. 126 years ago, folks. I don't know if you remember the story on that, but they had an old peach basket. I guess it was peach, potato, I don't know what it was. Anyway, one of those old baskets, and they hung it up. And in the beginning, the funny thing about that was, in the beginning, they had a guy with a ladder. And I don't know if they had a ladder. I guess they just had one basket. They hadn't worked out the full court with two baskets yet. They just had one basket. And had a guy with a ladder, and so when they'd shoot the ball into the basket, of course, it was in the basket, so it wouldn't, the guy had to put a ladder up, go up and get the ball out, throw it to him. And then, of course, shortly after that, somebody came up with a wise idea, hey, if we cut the bottom out of this basket, we won't have to be using this ladder, and which that makes pretty neat, sense there. So those are the kind of things that, you don't think about, and in today's time and all the technology and how modern the games are today, it kind of makes you laugh to think that at that time, they were putting a ball in the basket and then going up and taking it out of the basket. So, anyway, the first junior high was started 108 years ago in Berkeley, California. We used to hear all the time about how all the things started in California and then worked their way north to us and all that kind of stuff. That was one of the things. And In 1620, 103 Mayflower pilgrims landed at Plymouth Rock. That was 397 years ago, in case you were around then. And so anyway, those are some of the things like that. And this is the one that, gets me. General Patton, I don't know, you know, from such a great general, U.S. general in Sicily and Normandy. He dies in a car crash in 1945, the year I was born, at the age of 60. And this guy had gone through wars and gone through all this stuff and ended up dying in a car accident. That's, but man, he made more news at that time than most, probably anybody in history. And, so there was a time they kind of wanted him, they thought about him as the, like they did Eisenhower, you know, run for president and all that kind of stuff. But I don't think he was the – I think probably Patton would have been the Trump of the 1950s. You know, he was a no-nonsense kind of guy. You know, this is the way it is, and that's the way it's going to be, and that kind of thing. So, anyway, but those are a few little history lessons for you. And anything – oh, I know what I wanted to say, folks. Yeah. Hey, I don't know if you all have been watching the paper lately. They started the other day, and they're going through the top stories in Bradley County and Cleveland. And I think it's interesting as you're looking at this. The very first day, they started at number 10. Well, as it turns out, we got three that tied for number 10. We had the human trafficking, we had the whitewater rafting, and we had the hailstorm. Now, I can speak directly on that hailstorm because it did a lot of damage at our place, tore up our car, all those kind of things. Like, I know so many in the area had that. But, again, number 10 included three things: human trafficking, whitewater rafting, and hailstorm, okay? Then we go to number 9 yesterday, all right? And guess what? We got three tied for number 9. Now, do you all see a – something progressing here?
I see a pattern.
I see a pattern that could possibly be that before we're through, we're going to have 30. If it goes like this with three tied at each one of these, that'll be 30 different happenings. It was a busy year, so maybe. I don't know what's going to happen. We'll see today. Check your paper today and see what number 8 is. But again, number 9 was the Tennessee Reconnect and church security. Now, everybody was having people doing security things, the sheriff department and all that, teaching people and taking in people from the churches to help them learn how to protect their congregations and some in carrying weapons and stuff. And then a new city school was another one for the elementary school that's being built. So there was three for yesterday as number 9. So we'll keep our eyes open today to see what number 8, and as it progresses through this progression, we'll see how it turns out and what other things are out there. And maybe even some of them we'll get into a little bit more communication and talk about as this develops. But again, it was really also another one that came out here. I don't know if I should mention this, but the audit on our sheriff said that the audit from the BCSO allegations were baseless. So I don't know how that goes, what happens there. I don't know enough about it to even make a educational comment. So anyway, Coach Shriver here on the morning show, 614-5553. Give us a call if you got something on your mind. You got a few minutes left here before we close down for Christmas holidays. Remember, won't be here on tomorrow. We're going to take tomorrow off to be with family and celebrate Christmas. But we will be back a week from today, next Thursday, and we'll pick up there. But you can enjoy tomorrow, Monday and Tuesday. Have a great Christmas with your family. Remember the reason for the season, folks. The reason for the season. It's so, so important. And, Tom, you got anything you want to add or bring up here? And I'll see if I can find Mr. McCarthy here.
Yeah, this is just one thing with Whip Radio. You know, letters to Santa. I was reading this in the banner yesterday, and I appreciate the banner doing this. Whip Radio has a magic airways to Santa. I don't know if everybody knows that, but we can reach Santa. And there was one, Gracie Moses, and I just want to read what she said. I'm 3 years old. I've been a pretty good girl this year. For Christmas, I'd like a baby doll, a dollhouse, and some puzzles. Love you, Santa, and thank you, Gracie. So if we can't reach him, I'm sure that the Whoop Mule is on his way up there to take those letters up there for all the kids. And I wish them a Merry Christmas, and I hope you get everything you need on your Christmas tree.
Yes, sir. We're going to close out today with kind of a special Christmas thing. I don't know if you ever heard the Wonderful Christmas Time. Was that what it was with Paul McCartney?
Paul McCartney, yeah.
And so we're gonna play that for you to take us out today. And again, I want to say to you folks, hope everyone has a great, great Merry Christmas. And I want to emphasize that, Merry Christmas. And don't forget the reason for the season. But I hope you enjoy this song as we run it out, and we will be back and see you next Thursday. All right. Have a great one, folks. Appreciate you and love you.
Merry Christmas.
See you on the radio.
On Whoop Radio.
Drinks from the cafe, like the iced caramel macchiato.
The mood is right, the spirit's up, we're here tonight, and that's enough. Simply having a wonderful Christmas time. Simply having a wonderful Christmas time. The party's on, the feeling's here, that only comes this time of year. Simply having a wonderful Christmas time. Simply having a wonderful Christmas time. The choir of children sing their song. Right, the spirit's up, we're here.
I only hit snooze once. Well, no more than twice. My schizophrenia symptoms can make it tough to get going. And I don't want to worry about taking another daily schizophrenia pill. I'm doing better. I'm helping out at the cafe. Most days, I can spend my time doing what I like. Even though, every day, I live with schizophrenia.
Talk to your doctor about Invega Trinza, paliperidone palmitate. It's the only schizophrenia treatment that helps control symptoms for 3 months with one dose. You'll start on a monthly version of this medication for at least 4 months. Invega Trinza is not for everyone. Elderly patients with dementia taking Invega Trinza